7 and various other passages there. We know a lot about the life of David, but if you could boil the life of David down to one desire, it's written down for us here in Psalm 27. One thing have I asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord. Has it been good to be in a familiar home this past week? Maybe you went home to Mama's house. Maybe you are Mama and everyone was at your house. It's a great desire, it's a great longing, and some of us will be saying goodbye today. And there's that bittersweet feeling of, what's been this great time together, and yet those experiences weren't intended to last forever on this earth. I think David was acquainted with that. If we go back throughout the life of David and we try and put ourselves in some of his experiences, Psalm 27:5, think about David as a shepherd when his only home was a tent. Imagine your only home being a tent in November and it's cold and maybe there's snow and there's elements. And he says this, "For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock." Even in the exposure and desolation out there with those sheep, David understood that his home was to be with God. I think he took comfort from that. You move along in David's life and the next stage of his life where he's hiding in caves and he's trying to stand up and to be a man of righteousness and be a man of character because he knows that's who God is and that's the character that God asks of him. And yet the wicked are pursuing him. Verse 3, "Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though the war rise against me, yet I will be confident." He wants to be at home with God. He wants to know God and to know who God's character is. Even when he's sitting in this cave, you're out in the wilderness and you think, I'm going to hide in a cave. And it's better than being out here with these, you know, enemies. But you don't know what's in that cave, right? You don't know what animals are in there, what kind of dangers are in there. And yet here he is in these cold, dark places, only with his character and God's character to defend him. And then later on in life, he's at this place where he is wealthy and he's powerful and he has lots of responsibility. It's really the opposite of the fellow from Fiddler on the Roof. Maybe that's a dated reference, right? Like, if I were a rich man, right, then I could go in the synagogue and I could pray, and if I was rich, everything would be okay. Well, David is rich and he is powerful. And he's saying at the end of his life, or at this portion of his life, I just want to be in the house of God where I can pray and where I can know Him. He was reminded to be curious of God's nature. And we get this sense that throughout David's life that it was a delight for him to know God. When he asks to dwell in the house of the Lord, if you invited someone to live within your house, you were inviting them to know you. And David says, I want to know God. I want to see the beauty of God's character. And I want to always be fascinated with His eternal and divine nature. I'm going to start back up at the beginning of Psalm 27, and I'm going to emphasize some of the pronouns here. Psalm 27, verse 1, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" Go back to Psalm 23 for a moment. Psalm 23:6, that great prayer about the Lord being David's shepherd. I'm not just emphasizing the personal pronouns here to show that David was egocentric and self-centered, because what he's doing here is actually something different. "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me and all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." David took a personal delight in dwelling and knowing God. What does that mean? That he took a personal delight. He's not saying that, well, gee, I sure hope my folks choose to live in the house of God. Or I sure hope that someone else makes this decision for me. I remember it was about this time of year when I was finishing up my first semester in college. And you're excited to go away to school because you want to be independent and you want to get out from underneath your parents. I had a great home, but you want to get out and be independent and do your own thing. And yet you make it to Thanksgiving break and you come home and you sit down at the table and you're like, man, it is good to be home. It is good to be home. And you come back for a Christmas break, and I remember having this thought. And again, it wasn't because my home was a bad place. It was because I realized I have changed, and my family has changed. And though this is always my hometown, and this is always the home I grew up in, this place is no longer my home. Because, right, when we're young, home is something that is almost exclusively done to us, right? Grandparents, you understand this. It's the joy of your life right now. The little children come and you just get to make your house the happiest place, the safest place, the most content place that your grandchildren can appreciate. And all they have to do is just be their cute selves, right? There's no responsibility that they have to take in that role. And that same attitude in a college student kind of becomes awkward, right? When they come home and they're just like, just take care of me, and I really think I just want to be here and not be anywhere else. It's the transition from understanding that home is something that I must increasingly pursue. If I'm to have a happy home someday, I'm going to have to be the adult who creates this home, who creates this place. And David is saying, even in the wilderness, right, this shepherd psalm where he's talking about the Lord is his shepherd, he's saying that I must be the one who seeks the Lord's mercy. I must be the one who seeks the goodness of God. I must be the one who decides I want to be at home with my God. And I think the same transition happens and must always happen in our faith, that knowing God can no longer be someone else's job. We can expound upon the greatness of God's character, and we can show you ways to draw closer to God. But that desire to know who God is, that desire to live with God in that habitation that is referred to as Zion or the New Jerusalem or that heavenly home that we're supposed to stay in, that's no longer someone else's job. No one else can give that desire. It needs to be something that we desire for ourselves. Let's go over to Psalm 84. If you'll flip over there. We'll do some flipping today, this morning, but it'll primarily be in the Psalms. When knowing God is the home that we want to make for ourselves, it enables us to do some pretty incredible things. Now imagine David as the king. And people who thought about David and who thought about what David would say to God in worship in these Psalms. Psalm 84, verse 10. David is able to make statements like this. And those who followed in the footsteps of David were able to make statements like this. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. Right? There's that phrase that we throw out there, a bad day of fishing, right? A bad day of hunting is better than any day at work or whatever that place is that you'd perhaps rather not be. David says, a day in the courts of God, in the temple of God, in the tent of God, a day being at home with God is better than 1,000 days anywhere else. How desperate was his desire to be at home with God? And then this is really incredible for a king to say, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. He's saying, if the only job I can have within God's space, within his home, within his temple, if it's only to open the door and let other people in, and I just get to glance in and see. I mean, talk about the first being last. David was the first among his people, and he says, if I must be the very last person, right? Because the doorkeeper is the last one to go in after all of the guests have been allowed in. If I am the last person and my position is but a servant, it's better to be a servant in God's house than to dwell in the company of wickedness. Imagine that desire within us that is so genuine that whatever position we find ourselves within the church, whether it's a position of leadership or prestige or of honor or of teaching or of service or of servanthood, that we say, I would rather be a servant amongst God's people and in the presence of God than to give that up for anything else. It allows him to embrace the lower positions. Go back to Psalm 27. It also allows him to embrace something or to endure something that is difficult. Much more difficult, I would say. Psalm 27, verse 8. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. O you who have been my help, cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, and the Lord will take me in. Maybe for some of you that's been your experience. Probably not for most of us, to know what it's like to be forsaken by father and mother. But some of us know what that feeling is like. To be abandoned by people who ought to be our protectors and our guides and ought to be the most faithful. Even if we haven't experienced that, maybe our experience is similar to David. David had this great mentor and person he looked up to in Saul. And then Saul just went crazy. He was a tormented man who rejected David and even tried to kill him. And maybe you've had people in your life who you wanted to trust and learn from and yet betrayed that trust and turned upon you. Or David, Jesus, he's sitting amongst his followers and his mother and his brothers come to him, and what do they think about Jesus? Like, he's out of his mind. Jesus is nuts. Come on, Jesus, come back home. And Jesus understands what it was like to be forsaken by father and mother. And he says, you know, the people who do God's will are the one that I'm most at home with. David says, for my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in. There is always a place for David at the table in God's house, to be at home with his heavenly Father. And what a great assurance that is, to know that we can always be at home with God. Having this desire to know God and taking responsibility for it, it asks more of us. But for those of us who have begun those steps, we also know that it produces an enduring delight that is greater than anything we could have known about God before. Our young people, our children, have an awesome time in their Bible classes, and that's wonderful, and our teachers do such a great job of providing that for them. But there is a deeper and a higher and a greater joy, a more mature form of that, as we grow and we decide to make God our God and Father and to dwell with Him. Let's go back to the middle part of Psalm 27, verse 4. David says, I want to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life and to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. Back to Psalm 84, gazing upon His beauty. Psalm 84, verses 1 and 2. I know this is maybe just me as a guy. I have a hard time, like manly, passionate, wilderness-inspired David writing these words or inspiring these words. In fact, these may have not even been written by David, but someone who was thinking like him. How lovely is your dwelling place? I got to be honest, I don't use the word lovely very much. Maybe that's just me. Maybe I should more. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Can you imagine this man approaching the courts of God, and he's swooning, he's fainting. He has such a desire to be in God's presence. What is all this talk of beauty and of loveliness that inspires fainting and gazing in this great man of God? When I was in Alaska, in addition to preaching, I found my way into some substitute teaching, and I was in special ed programs, and I found my way into one of two programs. One was for students who had all of the physical and mental capabilities to succeed. And yet, because of tragic upbringing, their character was, it was a mess. It was ugly. They didn't know how to obey. And suddenly we became this like rehabilitation. You're trying to overcome what the home failed to do. That's almost impossible to do. And so we had these bright and capable students, and yet because of this ugliness of character, it was extremely difficult to teach them and work with them. On the complete flip side of that, I found myself working in this job training program for older students, and they had mental disabilities. Some of them had Down syndrome. Some of them had these experiences when they were young that just, they sort of stopped developing at about the sixth grade or so. But I tell you, their character, their kindness was beautiful. Their honesty. You'd say, all right, I know what your physical limitations are, but if you have the skills to be honest and to be fair and to be compassionate, someone is going to want to hire you. Someone is going to want to invest that in you. What is David talking about here? He says, I want to gaze into the beauty of God. He's saying, I want to see the beauty of God's character. I want to stand in awe of who God is. I want God to be more than just words and stories in a text. I want to know the person behind this story. I want that character to be mine as well. To live with God, to dwell in God's holiness and in His temple, is to be inspired by His character behind the story. Psalm 65, verse 4. Seeing God's character is a bit of a double-edged sword, and I think David wanted that. Psalm 65, verse 4. Blessed is the one that you choose and bring near to dwell in your courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of your house and with the holiness of your temple. Goodness and holiness. The story of David sparing Saul's life. I don't understand how David didn't kill Saul after Saul, after all he did to him. David is sitting in this cave and he has this perfect opportunity to take out this enemy. And yet, almost preaching Jesus' later teaching that you should pray for your enemies instead of attack them and kill them and fight with them, David prays for Saul and he spares Saul's life. And he says, I can't wound God's anointed. And he feels bad about even ripping some of his garment. And I stand in awe of this character that David possesses and how good David is in that moment. And I say, yes, if we had more people like that, that would make a difference in this world. Dwelling with God is seeing His character, seeing His goodness. And then I come across stories like Jesus cleansing the temple. I mean, it was a good thing that Jesus cleansed the temple, but would you have wanted to see Jesus like that? Clearing out the temple, saying, my zeal has overcome me, and this ought to be a place of prayer, and yet it's being abused by these merchants. I have an appreciation for stained glass. I suppose you can see that. But does anyone really look afraid in that picture? Does Jesus really look impassioned? I don't know, maybe emotion is hard to put into stained glass. I don't know. It's good, and it's a beautiful representation, a different time, I suppose. But then there's this graphic, and I got to feel like the fella to your left in that bottom corner who is terrified of this holy Son of God coming in and clearing out the temple. I mean, it's terrifying. The beauty of God is both attractive and something that we desire, and we say, yes, God is good, and I see that. And yet there are stories, like Jesus clearing the temple, where we want to fall down and tremble before His holiness. And it makes us think not, well, God is bad, but we think about how small we are and how foolish we can be. A lot of talk of safe spaces today. Jesus offered no safe space for evil within the temple of His God. To see God's beauty is to read about His character and to reread about His character in Scripture. This French fellow here who wrote some books about Jesus said this, "If you would tell me the heart of a man, tell me not what he reads, but what he rereads." God's beauty is something we must always come back to. We must not water it down and we must not ignore it, but we must gaze intently into the character of God in His Word. Let's finish up in Psalm 27. I love that Jay paused toward the end of that where he said in verse 13, "I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord and be strong. Let your heart take courage and wait for the Lord." Anyone in here really good at waiting? I mean, and you can't have your phone either, okay? You're not allowed to have your phone. You have to wait. When's the last time you sat and you read something and then you just pondered that? Or maybe you're riding in the car and you have this thought about Scripture or this question and all you do is think about it. And you know, I could Google this and probably get somebody else's answer. But you ponder that. You wait and you allow God to work upon you. Notice what he says here in verse 11. He says, "Teach me your way, O God, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, or false witnesses have risen against me, and they breathe out violence." You know, the old hymns are old, but they are meditations of great men and women of faith. "Thy way, not mine, O Lord." Notice how he is meditating about what it takes to wait upon God and to dwell upon God's nature. "The kingdom that I seek is thine, so let the way that leads to it be thine, else I must surely stray. Take thou my cup, and it with joy or sorrow fill, as best to thee may seem, choose thy my good or ill. Choose thou for me my friends, my sickness or my health. Choose thou my cares for me, my poverty and my wealth." Boy, what a beautiful thought that came because he was curious about God's nature, that God is unchanging and that he is the one that needs to change. Now, I understand that curiosity, that inquiring in the temple of God, that having curiosity, well, what do we say? Curiosity killed the cat, right? I get that. Now, cats, if you've ever seen a cat brain, there's not a lot of, hey, I have a cat, so I'm not insulting cat people. But the cat brain doesn't have a lot of space for measuring consequences, right? They just sort of go after things recklessly. And I'm convinced that my cat looks in the mirror and sees this. And if she was as big as a lion, she probably would eat me, right? If she could. There is a brand of curiosity that is reckless, that is divisive, that takes this book and says, well, there's new morality that has come out since this thing was published. There's a brand of curiosity that I understand is dangerous. But there's also the curiosity that Jesus displayed when he was in the temple with the elders. Isn't that a baffling story? Jesus, 12 years old, Son of God, goes to the temple, and what does he do? He stands up and he tells everybody how it is, right? No. He sits and he asks questions. What did he ask about? You thought about that? What questions would Jesus be inquiring? What answers would he be giving these well-learned men? Whatever it is, I think Jesus' desire to sit and converse and to ponder, to be amongst God's people, is a good example for us. I think it's a sign of spiritual apathy if learning about God does not inspire in us wonder and bafflement and amazement. Be awed by God and the questions that you come across when you study His nature. I think it's a sign of worldly conformity if spiritual discussion is not a steady part of our Christian life. And so who do you engage with? David says, "My one desire is to live in the house of God and to gaze into His beauty and to inquire within His temple." Who do you have in your life that joins you in those spiritual discussions? Who can you ask questions of to know God and to dwell with Him? Oswald Chambers is an old devotional writer, and in this graphic here, he wrote that my goal is God Himself. Not joy or peace, not even blessing, but Himself, my God. David didn't always see that, but David never completely lost sight that his true home was with God. That peace and safety and blessing were byproducts or symptoms of a life lived in service to God. And yet he remembered what his goal was. Are you satisfied? Are you satisfied? Say yes. After Thursday, I was very satisfied and full. But that's not my question. My question is, are you spiritually satisfied? Or do you have a hunger and a desire to be at home with God? I pray that you'll make time this evening to come back, because we're going to talk some more about growing in knowing Him. Are you growing in your journey of knowing more about God? If you need to respond to that desire to know God better for yourself, then let us be helpful in that. If you need to return to God and say, I have lost my desire, my desire is cold and it is hard and it needs to be rekindled, then respond and come back, and we'd like to help you with that. Please join us while we stand together and sing.